Welcome back to the Carbon Classes channel, and today we are going to talk about aspirin. So in the last lecture we had seen the classification and the mechanism of action of NSAIDs, and continuing in the NSAIDs we are going to talk about aspirin today. So basic introduction about the aspirin. Aspirin is an NSAID, and as we know it is non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, and it is used in the treatment of pain, angina, fever, and it is anti-inflammatory and antiplatelet in nature. So I had already covered the mode of action previously. Classification is also done. Now just talking about the pharmacological action of aspirin. Now firstly, aspirin has got analgesic effect. So analgesia is NSAIDs are mainly used for relieving musculoskeletal pain. Guys, I would also cover some of the important points of other drug in this topic, in aspirin. So please do follow what I'm talking. So NSAIDs are mainly used for relieving musculoskeletal pain, dysmenorrhea, and pain associated with tissue damage. So this is the work of NSAIDs. You can put this point anywhere, that analgesic effect, all NSAIDs are mainly used for relieving musculoskeletal pain, dysmenorrhea, and pain associated with tissue damage. Now analgesic effect is mainly due to peripheral inhibition of prostaglandin production. Okay, so they relieve pain without causing sedation, respiratory depression, and tolerance or dependence. Respiratory depression was the main problem with morphine. So this does not cause any respiratory depression or cause any tolerance or dependence. So aspirin that produce analgesia is 2 to 3 grams per day. So the dose that of aspirin to produce analgesic effect is 2 to 3 grams per day. Guys, I do not mean to just suggest you what amount of aspirin is needed, but it is a data that is given in the books. So that is the data I am reflecting. I do not mean, please refer to your clinical practice of the clinical doses that I suggest. So I am not meaning to suggest any such of the data to you. This data is all given in the books, all referred by the books. So now talking about the antipyretic effect. Now talking about the antipyretic effect, the antipyretic effect is mainly due to inhibition of prostaglandins in the hypothalamus. The dose that produce antipyretic effect is 2 to 3 grams per day. They promote this antipyretic effect is they cause the loss of heat by cutaneous vasodilation and sweating. So they promote the loss of heat by cutaneous vasodilation and sweating. Nextly guys, anti-inflammatory effect. Anti-inflammatory effect is seen in higher doses for aspirin. That is 4 to 6 gram per day for aspirin. Produce only symptomatic relief but does not stop the progression of the disease. So on very high doses, that is 4 to 6 gram for aspirin, they produce the symptomatic relief, but it does not stop any progression of the disease. The anti-inflammatory action of NSAIDs is mainly due to inhibition of prostaglandin synthesis at the site of injury. Okay guys, now talking about the antiplatelet effect. The low doses of aspirin, that is 50 to 325 milligrams per day of aspirin, irreversibly inhibits the platelet thromboxane A2 synthesis and produce antiplatelet effect, which lasts for 8 to 10 days. So basically antiplatelet effect is done by aspirin. High doses of aspirin is not given for antiplatelet effect. I am going to tell the reason now onwards. But firstly, remember this, in low doses, it shows antiplatelet effect, and which lasts for 8 to 10 days. Now guys, just understand a simple concept. Aspirin, when given in low doses, that is 50 to 325 milligrams per day, inhibits thromboxane A2. And this thromboxane A2 causes vasoconstriction and promotes platelet aggregation. So this effect is not seen when we give it in low dose, but when aspirin given to in doses of 2 to 3 grams per day, it inhibits thromboxane A2 and PGI2. Now this thromboxane A2, it will cause vasoconstriction and promote platelet aggregation, but this PGI2 causes vasodilation and inhibit platelet aggregation. So both the functions are being cancelled, so there would be no antiplatelet effect. If in low doses it is given, then this effect, the thromboxane A2, it causes vasoconstriction and promote platelet aggregation, this effect would not be seen. So that is how it promotes antiplatelet effect. Now at a dose of 2 to 3 grams, antiplatelet effect is lost and aspirin inhibits both thromboxane A2 and PGI2. Now talking about more effects, acid base and electrolytic balance, salicylates cause respiratory alkalosis. GIT, aspirin irritates the gastric mucosa and produce nausea, vomiting and dyspepsia. Dyspepsia is upper abdominal discomfort. So now talking about CVS, prolonged use of aspirin and other NSAIDs cause sodium and water retention. Urate excretion, salicylates and therapeutic doses inhibit urate excretions in renal tubules and increase plasma urate levels. Now talking the pharmacokinetics for the salicylates. These salicylates are rapidly absorbed by upper GI tract. They highly bond to the plasma protein, but their binding is saturable. They are well distributed through the tissues and body fluids and metabolized in the liver. If increased in concentration, they can cause surf toxicity. This is a simple pharmacokinetic, that is salicylates, easily absorbed or rapidly absorbed and bond to plasma protein, well distributed through the tissues, and if increased concentration can occur surf toxicity. Now doses for aspirin, as I have already told you, analgesic dose is 2 to 3 grams per day, anti-inflammatory 4 to 6 grams per day, and antiplatelet effect 50 to 325 milligrams per day. Now talking about the adverse effects, this is the main thing guys, because on the function the adverse effects are important. So GIT tract, now nausea, vomiting, dyspepsia, epigastric pain, acute gastritis, ulceration and GI bleeding. Adverse effect of aspirin guys: nausea, vomiting, dyspepsia, epigastric pain, acute gastritis, ulceration and GI bleeding. Okay guys, matlab we are getting upper abdominal discomfort, then there is pain, then pain causes inflammation of that is termed as acute gastritis. Now there is formation of these ulcers which and through these ulcers there is bleeding. Now ulcerogenic effect is major drawback of NSAIDs, which is prevented by having NSAIDs. So the ulcerogenic effect can be easily prevented by having NSAIDs by after food. Buffered aspirin can be taken, that is it is prepared with an antacid, proton pump inhibitors, H2 blockers or misoprostol with NSAIDs, and selective COX-2 inhibitors can be taken. So these are the ulcerogenic effect is the main thing, so these can be prevented. So now hypersensitivity reaction. Talking about the hypersensitivity, it is more common with aspirin, as manifestations are skin rashes, the urticaria, rhinitis is running nose, and bronchospasm, and angioneurotic edema, and rarely anaphylactic reaction. So basically cause hypersensitivity, and the manifestation of this hypersensitivity is skin rashes, urticaria, rhinitis, bronchospasm. Now this bronchospasm, that is aspirin induced asthma, is due to increased production of leukotrienes. So this is the main thing what causes bronchospasm. In people with G6PD deficiency, administration of salicylates may cause hemolytic anemia. And then prolonged use of salicylates interfere with the action of vitamin K in the liver, which further causes decrease in the synthesis of clotting factor, which predispose to bleeding. Now talking about Reye's syndrome. Guys, Reye's syndrome is seen in children. So firstly, Reye's syndrome is seen in children. So this syndrome is seen in children with viral infection and may cause hepatic damage, with fatty infiltration and encephalopathy. Encephalopathy is a brain disease, and this infection is a tumor or a stroke. So salicylates are contraindicated in children with viral infection. So this Reye syndrome is seen in children which have viral infection. The factor is viral infection, and it causes hepatic damage with fatty infiltration and encephalopathy. So kar kya raha hai? It is causing infiltration and encephalopathy with hepatic damage. So you need to contraindicate salicylates in viral infections. Now talking about pregnancy, the pregnancy, these drugs inhibit prostaglandin secretion, thereby delay the onset of labor and increase the chances of postpartum hemorrhage. So this is the adverse effect. It stops the PG prostaglandin synthesis and thereby delay the onset of labor. Now analgesic nephropathy. Slowly progressive renal failure may also occur on chronic use of high doses of NSAID. Slow progressive renal failure. So it is affecting kidneys too. So slow progressive renal failure may occur on the chronic use of high doses of aspirin. Now basically talking about the clinical uses of NSAIDs. Basically analgesic in conditions like musculoskeletal pain, toothache, headache, and your backache, body ache, muscle pain, joint pain. Now as antipyretic to reduce elevated body temperatures and fever, paracetamol is preferred. GI symptoms are rare and it does not cause Reye syndrome. So guys, paracetamol is preferred. You can take it empty stomach, but I prefer do not take any medications empty stomach. It may cause trouble to your gastric mucosa. So to reduce the elevated body temperature and fever, paracetamol is preferred as GI symptoms are rare and it causes Reye syndrome. It does not causes Reye syndrome in children. Now rheumatoid arthritis, NSAIDs have anti-inflammatory effect, so they can produce only symptomatic relief and they do not alter the progression of the disease. Now osteoarthritis, in mild cases paracetamol is used. In severe cases, other NSAIDs are more effective than PCM. Topical agents like methyl salicylates and diclofenac gel can be used in osteoarthritis. Now acute rheumatic fever, aspirin is preferred drug. It reduces fever, relieves swelling and joint pain. Aspirin is the most preferred drug and it reduces fever, relieves swelling and joint pain, but does not affect the normal course of the disease. That is, these drugs are not affecting the course of the disease, but it is giving the symptomatic relief. Now thromboembolic effects. Like we know that it is antiplatelet effect of low doses of aspirin, it may use in the prophylactic treatment of various thromboembolic disorders like transient ischemic attacks and myocardial infarction. So aspirin is used. Now other uses of various other NSAIDs are medical closure of patients ductus arteriosus. In this we prefer indomethacin. In case aspirin, in place of aspirin we prefer indomethacin. Now colon and rectal cancer, regulate the use of aspirin is reported to reduce the risk of cancer. So regular use of aspirin is reported to reduce the risk of cancer. Now aspirin is reported to reduce the risk and retard the onset of Alzheimer's disease. So these guys are only just reportings. Refer to the clinical trials. I again remind you. So to control radiation and induced diarrhea, aspirin is used to control radiation induced diarrhea. Low doses of aspirin may be used in preeclampsia. So guys, this is all for today's video. In this lecture I had covered all about aspirin. Hope you would like it. I think it was a really fast, but there are too many topics to cover, so the video might be a little fast. Go slow with it. Read each and every point and copy these points. These are very important. I have told it in a very simplified manner. Thank you guys for watching. Keep subscribing the channel. Hope you would further follow us with more likes. Thank you guys.